Good afternoon, everyone. We are excited to continue our ICAP webinar series. Today, I will be sharing with you all about internships. I know there have been a lot of inquiries and there have been new resources that are now available to you all. So I want to make sure you get that. Before I continue to proceed, I know that it sounds like someone's mic is unmuted. So if you don't mind muting that, would greatly appreciate that. So as I mentioned, this webinar, it will be recorded. And what I will do is I will send the PowerPoint and the recorded webinar link to you, probably get it by tomorrow. But we will house this on OK Edge after, of course, we do some closed captioning to get it available for accessibility purposes.
Before you go, let me pause this mute.
Okay. Pause for 1 second, please.
That's what you think.
Okay.
It'll make a little blip in your video. It'll be so nice. No, I promise you that.
Thank you. Okay, so we're going to continue for today. And again, this is the ICAP webinar series that is focused on internships, connection to completion. Today, we are going to find out about what is an internship when we say that. How does internships connect to ICAP? What is the value of internships? Why is it beneficial for our students to experience these types of work-based learning? And then also talk about internship course credit. Internship guidelines, and then of course, how do we go about finding internships and what does that process look like? And then I will close it with some upcoming resources and events that are coming quickly on the calendar, and then answer any questions that you may have pertaining to this, this topic or any other questions you have. And also, just a reminder, you'll need to use your chat box if you have any questions. So I will occasionally look on my chat box and answer them as soon as possible. So what is an internship? Well, really an internship, it is a component of work-based learning. And it's really to allow our students the opportunity to get those hands-on experiences. And so internships, they can be short-term, or they can be, really, this is a short-term process for our students. So I will talk about how it's connected semester-wise. But we want our students to have that exposure, to have more equipping with those employability skills, those professional behaviors, and what are the details surrounding that. So basically, an internship is really giving those students an opportunity to gain that work experience for a short-term period, and also in this case, to receive credit for the post-secondary opportunities indicator. So when we talk about internships, how does this really connect to ICAP? I would always like to direct you all back to our ESSA plan, Every Student Succeeds Act. And within our ESSA, we specifically had one of our goals that said that 100% of our students entering or who are in the grades 6 through 12 will have developed a meaningful individual career academic plan, which we call an ICAP. And so the purpose of ICAP is to make sure that our students, their skills, their interests, and their abilities are connected with their academic, post-secondary, and workforce goals. So the requirements of ICAP, and hopefully you have all familiarized yourself with this. And again, ICAP stands for Individual Career Academic Planning, but from this point forward, I'm just going to call it ICAP. So the requirements of ICAP is participation in career and college interest surveys, written post-secondary and workforce goals and showing progress towards those goals, the intentional sequence of courses that students take so that a student won't just be enrolled into a course because that's what their friend is participating in, but they'll be enrolled into a course that really connects with something they're interested about. And then showing academic progress, scores on college and career readiness assessment. And then the last one, which is an experience in service learning, And the law says and our work environment activities. But in this case, for the term of Oklahoma, we're going to use work-based learning because that encompasses work environment activities. So that's what we're going to talk about today, that last bullet point. And I want to, instead of showing and telling you about what the value of internship is, I actually want to share with you a video from one of our local school districts who really started the process of internships. And then from that, a lot of school districts have catched on with that fire and that excitement and have been utilizing this model. So I want you to see that today.
Gage, what letter is this?
B.
Catbury Chapin loves working with kindergartners.
What sounds to make more?
She knew from a very young age teaching was her passion.
And then when they come in, I'm just here for them and ready for them.
Across town at Advantage Controls, Levi East has also found his passion.
After just a few days, I automatically just started loving it.
While Catbury and Levi may be working very different jobs, they both have something in common. They are seniors at Hilldale High School in Muskogee.
The business people are saying we don't really have a workforce, and my kids are saying, well, we don't know what to do. We don't know what we're going to do. Felt to me like there was a gap there.
Hilldale Superintendent Kaylin Cootey knew she needed to do something to close that gap. That's when the internship program came to life.
I know a lot of my classmates don't know what they wanted to, and some of them still don't. And this is kind of get you out in the field and see what like a working job is, you know, 8 to 5 days, see what you're going to get yourself into.
Each of them filled out a request form, giving me 3 or 4 options of things that they were interested in.
Superintendent Cootey then went to work to convince local businesses to take on her students as interns.
It was a very hard sell for the businesses. It was a very hard sell. I was surprised at that.
However, concerns faded, and now more businesses want to be a part of the program.
We're pretty blown away. We're happy with it, and we're ready to have more.
I've told the employers that you treat them like an employee, and if an employee is tardy, what would you do? That's what you need to do. And if that includes writing them up, you send that to me, and I'll make sure that that's reflected when we grade them.
Each student spends 8 weeks at their job site, arriving daily for an hour and a half. For some students, it has reaffirmed their career plan, like Michael, who wants to be a pilot in the military and was placed at Davis Airfield.
I've learned a lot out there about how they land and directions and altitude.
For others, it has opened their eyes to other opportunities.
I was going to go into the law enforcement field, and then Dr. Cootey placed me over at Advantage Terrafab, and then I started learning how to weld and all the guys, and honestly, I just really started liking it a lot. So, you know, I got a little bit more into it, started learning all the little techniques and all the little gizmos that all go with it. And honestly, that's what I'm going to do now.
I was thinking radiology in the beginning, but being with, I think, labor and deliveries, like my area, we've got to step in and watch C-sections and natural births. Like, we've been in and got to see a lot.
The class is a semester long, giving each student a chance to work at 2 job sites. The employer gives a performance review and the student is graded. Superintendent Cootey is pleased with how the internship program played out this first year and has this advice for other school districts looking to start a similar program.
The main thing is matching up students' interests with the places that you can get them. I think that's the most critical. If we just put them somewhere because a business or an industry offered to take one, but it's not their area of interest, I don't know that we've gained a whole lot.
But with the right match, what students can gain is a path to a successful future.
Has this changed your mind at all about what you want to do?
No. If anything, it's just more solidified.
Get my certification, go next year to ICTC down the road, and just get my whole life started, pretty much.
Okay, everyone, I hope you enjoyed that video. It's a great video because the former superintendent, Dr. Cootey, as you saw, was really showcasing and saying that we just don't want to place our students anywhere when it comes to internships. We really want to make sure that we're matching them with their skills and their interest set. And so that is really getting back to the ICAP. How do we make sure that this is what they want to do? And what's great about internships and what I love about it is that they get to experience all of this while in high school. So it saves some financial debt later on, or it just saves them saying, I don't know if I want to go to this field and changing majors and all of that interesting things that can happen when they become and walk across that stage. So when it comes to internship and course credit, what does that look like from the State Department of Ed lens? Some some guidance for you is that internships are only for juniors and seniors. So I really want to make that very clear. Also, internships, they can be paid or unpaid and still receive credit towards the post-secondary opportunities indicator. So I know I've had questions about that. So yes, internships paid or unpaid and get the credit. Also, just to be mindful that internships are a work-based learning opportunity that also meet the ICAP requirement. So that's where they fall within ICAP. And then just a clarification that has been a lot of inquiries that we have received recently is just to let you know that service learning, and that's the course code 2775, it can meet the ICAP requirement, but the course code does not count towards the post-secondary opportunities indicator. So I wanted to just clear that up if there's any confusion. Another information about internship course credit is that it has to be, students can earn credit towards internships again in the junior or senior year. We really have structured it similarly to concurrent enrollment, meaning we have told schools that you can calculate for drive time so that students can earn up to 2 credits per year for an internship. And if a student wants to earn more than 2 credits or more than the 2 hours, well, they have to petition the board. And if the board approves that, then they're able to do 3 hours if that better fits their schedule. Again, that will be a local board policy. And then also just a reminder that this internship course codes, and I'm about to show you the codes specifically, they are for a semester course. These are the internship course credit codes. It is 2790 internship 1, and that'll be specifically for juniors. And then 2791 is internship 2, and that is specifically for seniors. So those are the 2 course codes that you need. I have also depicted the course codes that are applicable to career tech onto the right-hand side, the 8000, so that you can see what those are, because I know there were have been some confusions in the past, especially the last reporting of the school report card. Some school districts had unclarification about what course codes were available, so I wanted to make sure that you had the accurate ones when it comes and pertains to internships. So some guidance on internships. We say that districts should consider developing local policies and guidelines because, as I mentioned earlier, it is a local decision. So within your district board policy, you want to have verbiage and information that contains and pertains to internships. So the following will need to be included. The first is the agreements between the school and business. We have included, we are about to launch and release so that everyone can have a business and education partnership toolkit. And so some of these links we have already put on OK Edge under business and community for you to access them. But you will also see this and more guidance in that business and education partnership toolkit that will be released in the coming weeks. But the first example I wanted to share with you is the sample partnership development agreement. What's really good about this is that it is a Word document. You can customize it, put your own logo on it, and that helps give you at least a guidance of what an agreement looks like when you're going out to those businesses. We've also provided a sample partnership letter, so, customizable if you want to use a letter format. Of course, we always say picking up the phone is a great recommendation, or doing face-to-face with a business. Really gain that rapport before you just ask that I want to do an internship. But now that I mentioned ask, I want to just say as a recommendation to understand what your ask is when you're going into in front of industry, business, or community members, to really know, define what you're asking of them, what you need from them, how you see this partnership continuing on just a monthly basis or maybe even long term. So just have that all set out before you go into the presence. That will really help you. So that's just a personal recommendation from myself. We've also included some examples from that video you just saw about Hilldale Public Schools. You will get these links again after this webinar tomorrow, of course. But that Hilldale Senior Internship Program, it breaks it down specifically, and it shows how Dr. Cootie had a business letter and what form she sent to the businesses, what form she required of her students to complete, and et cetera. And the same is true of Loudoun Public Schools. This shows some reflection pieces, how after an intern participated in the program, how did the business evaluate them? How did they grade them? What would they say about that? So those are some good examples for you as you get started in an internship program at your local school. Another thing that should be or will need to be included within your policy is some grading rubrics for school students and business. What does that look like? I really recommend the Loudoun Public Schools internship program because they broke it down very nicely. Just to show you, you don't have to make it like this. Again, make it what's easy for your school, but also what is around your local region. So don't get overwhelmed if you see someone doing it like this. Make it what's feasible for your school district. And then feedback forms for businesses, and then workplace safety. So again, you'll need agreements between the school and business. You'll need grading rubrics for schools, students, and business, and feedback forms for business, and then workplace safety. And that will all need to be in your local policy and having the guidelines for an internship program at your school. I have also provided a link for our business and community partnership guides on OK Edge, so that way you have access to all of these documents that you may find necessary. If there's a document that you don't see and you're like, Chelsea, I need that, please send me an email and let me know. And my goal is always to make sure you have the resources that you need. So if you see something that would be beneficial for all school districts, please let me know. So how do you go about finding internships? This is a very good question. From the school district site, it's really if you're able to identify a college and career readiness staff. There are some school districts, I think off the top of my head, we have Shawnee, we have Duncan, we have Pryor, just to mention a few, who have specific person who is the college and career readiness coordinator, or who is the liaison between the State Department and the liaison between the district and the businesses. And what that person does is they really evaluate their students, give them an assessment, whether that's an interest survey on OK College Start or OK Career Guide, and then they get intentional about making sure they're looking at the businesses in their area and they're vetting those businesses and contacting them with those letters or those phone calls and reaching out to your chambers, your workforce directors. And I have some contacts in the following slides to show you who to reach out to, and creating, of course, those agreements, and then getting the students placed into the field. Many school districts have started, they do it typically where students are in session, they're in class for maybe 2 or 3 weeks, and then they go out into the field. So when you're in class, that's a great time to talk about how do we write an email? How do we write an email? How do we show up to work on time? What's our dress code when we go to work? How do we shake someone's hand? How do we speak to them? Yes, sir, no, sir, yes, ma'am, no, ma'am, et cetera. So that's the good time, those couple of weeks during the class period, to really build on those employability skills, teach the students specific things about what they need to know and before you send them into their field of interest. From a State Department level, I am your contact myself, who I am that liaison between the school and the businesses and community. And so I really like to just talk to that one person at the school, so that college and career readiness person or the person who's assigned to talk to those businesses, because it'll make it easier and then that person can disseminate the information to the school. Also, what we do at the State Department is we provide guidance and resources for you in the areas of any work-based learning opportunities, and work-based learning includes job shadowing, mentorship, apprenticeships, and of course, internships, just to mention a few. And so that site is really the link that you need for all of these guides. The next slide, when I talked about how you go and just how do you even just get started, one of the first things suggested is to connect with your local workforce development board executive director. And what I've done is I've listed their names, where they fit in the regions. And if you're not familiar with the state of Oklahoma, we have 7 workforce development regions ranging from central, eastern, northeast, south, central, southern, Tulsa, and western. And each region is very different when it comes to industry, but these local workforce boards have connections to a plethora of businesses and can help get you connected. And sometimes they even have funding that can help with as a resource to you. So I've listed all their names, connections straight to their website and how to call them. And they all know that I'm sharing their contact information and they're readily available to help you. Another recommendation that I would say is contact your local Chamber of Commerce. Your local Chamber of Commerce will also have connections with a plethora of businesses and can help also be your voice in the field. Sometimes when you say you're doing a senior conference or you're doing a big career fair or some kind of activity that you need, having your local Chamber of Commerce, having a connection there can help. They can help with the getting the word out more on a public scale. And so we even say when you're having an internship program or a career fair or anything like that, reach out and make sure you reach out to your local medias and have them showcase that event, because you want to be proud of the work that you've done and you want to make sure that you're just highlighting the good things that are going on in your school district. So again, connect with your local workforce development board. Secondly, connect with your local chambers of commerce. And then once you've done that, what we really recommend is if you were in our ICAP pilot study, then you were a part of the group who created an ICAP team. And one member of that team was focused on business and community. And so we're taking it a step further when we now start talking about business and community, and it's talking about creating a school partnership team. So really, what does that look like? If you're on the side from industry and community, you want to have people on your team who are from human resources, people who, again, are from that local workforce development board, from your chambers, from marketing, public affairs, et cetera. Oh, and tribal nations. There's many of our school districts who have connections with various tribal nations out there, and that's another good resource to help you either provide an internship or just in any capacity of your work-based learning experience opportunities you're trying to get to your students. When it comes to the side of creating a school partnership team from a school district level, you really want to have on your team your superintendents and or your principals, your counselors and your teachers, making sure that they're all informed. Then your parents, of course, and your students, getting that word out, making sure everyone is up to date, because it's not just going to be on one person's shoulders to get this done. That won't be feasible, nor can that happen. You're going to need people around you to help you get this done. So youth and family coordinators, there's amazing community partners who are out here who are willing and able to help with you. And then even having your site advisory council to come in and give that perspective for you, and again, of course, your college and career readiness staff. And once you started with the getting started and you've learned and reached out to those you need to connect with, then you proceed into creating that school partnership team. Well, then the next phase is really developing that outreach plan. And I know this sounds extensive, but I want to let you guys also, and just a good reminder, is that when ICAP became implemented this school year, it was for those entering in the ninth grade. So that is our students who are the graduating class of 2023. So they're not even going to be juniors or seniors yet. So we have time. We have about 2 years to help get your internship program started and up and running. So you have time to reach out to businesses and community members. Then you have time to make a plan of how you want to incorporate this into your scheduling. And then also we have also on the business and community website on OKEdge.com, We provided a school calendar so you can see how to implement these activities. And of course, today I'm really only speaking of the lens of internships, but I wanted you to know about all the resources for you. But all of this to say, just that we have time to build a good quality internship program. So don't think that it needs to happen overnight. We have time. So develop your outreach plan. What does that look like? How do you start begin that work to communicate with external stakeholders who it's going to be vital? First is to just recognize that, and I've been in the presence of the business and community members, and they are excited and ready to partner with you. So I always say again, know what your ask is. What is it that you're seeking from this partnership with them? So if it's in the lens of internships, how long is this agreement going to be? What is the requirements that you expect of the business? Do you want them to grade your student after they've participated in the internship? Do you want them, and some districts have it like that, where it's like Dr. Cootie said in her video, it's okay for a business person to say, hey, you're not being up to par because you're not showing up on time. And in the real world, that would cause you to be fired from your position. So have that communication between that college and career readiness staff member or whoever the person is designated at your district or your site level. And then let the student know this is real. This is that, again, gaining the work experience like it is a job. So they need to take it serious. And so how do you put that into your developing plan when you do that? I mentioned earlier, what's going to be your communication plan? How are you going to get the word out about the internships? And so that other businesses, once you've started, and it's okay to start small. You might just start with 5 businesses the first time you ever do this program, and that's okay. But how do you start reaching out more and developing an outreach plan so you can get more businesses to come? And not only just more businesses, you got to be mindful to get those businesses that connect with your students' interests. So once you're given those interest surveys, being really mindful, okay, if my student wants to be a nurse, what health opportunities can I get them in? And I was listening at a conference recently, and a gentleman spoke up, and he was really mentioning how, you know, hospitals are a great avenue for an internship. And I know sometimes it's the liability thing, that's not always the case. But in this instance, he was talking about how his internship program was really thankful for the hospital, because some students just felt like you could only be a doctor or a nurse at a hospital, but that's not the case. You have janitorial staff, you have food prep staff, you have those who go around and they push, and I'm sorry, I don't know the name of this, but they push the patients around. You have so many jobs that are within a hospital, so that's a great avenue, but there's a plethora of different avenues to get your students connected. And then just again, that the reason for an outreach plan is because this is a part of the sustainability. You don't want it just to have an internship program for one time, you want it to continually to build upon it and to grow and to sustain it for futures. And so again, you got time because ICAP just started and we have a couple of years before these ninth graders get into their junior and senior year. So this is your work a plan time. And so that's a good thing. So if you have questions, reach out to me, and I don't mind being your thought partner. That's a good thing about this. Okay. And that really kind of was the end of the internship piece of this presentation. So I want to pause now for any questions, and I'm going to open my chat box so I can make sure to see them. Mm-hmm. So are there any questions at this point in the presentation? And that's okay, we're still going through the presentation, but if you have questions about internships, or maybe you have a generic question about ICAP or a question about a different avenue of work-based learning, please reach out to me or put it in this chat, and then I will also share my contact information for you, or a way for you to contact us. This ICAP webinar series, we really want your feedback. This series kicked off in January of 2019, And it's going to conclude in December of 2019. And we have a few more sessions to go. And want to make sure that before it ends, you get topics that are of interest to you. And that just helps to make sure that we are getting the guidance and the resources that you need. Typically, I bring in guest speakers, but this time I've had a lot of questions about internships. So I really wanted to solely focus on a session about internships. But we will have some future various businesses come in, community members, various school districts come in and give their perspective, whether they were a pilot school, an ICAP pilot school or not. But just really getting information. So we've had information on the two online tools, OK College Start and OK Career Guide. We've had information on alternative education, information about ICAP and how you connect the dots to career development. Of course, this one on internships, and we will have some upcoming webinars that's going to be about how do you even do a career fair and what does that look like, even if you're a rural school district, because this was a rural school district who got inspired by a large school district and now they put it on for their county. So that's an upcoming as well. But this is just a link to the survey, just to let us know how we're doing, what you need, what's the resources that you need so we can make sure we get them into your hands. Our next webinar, if you'll mark your calendars, it's going to be October 17th of 2019. That's a Thursday. And I see a question I'm about to answer, I promise. That's the registration link for you as well. And right now, I'm just waiting on one person to confirm. Either that webinar will be on mentorships, or what I'll do is I'll share with you an ICAP meeting that's coming up, and you're welcome to participate in that. So just keep your eyes out for it. We will get communication on what that webinar will specifically be about. Hopefully it's on mentorships, but if not, I will let you know. So I'm gonna break real fast for a question, and let's see. How many credits of an internship are required in order for a student to meet the ICAP requirement? So you get one credit per semester, so you can get a total of 2 credits, and that will meet the internship requirement. So that's the course codes again, 2790 for juniors and 2791 for seniors. Another question, or just statement as well. I'm having difficulty getting students into areas of the medical field. Any suggestions? So that's a great question. I want to tell you, you're not alone. We have some school districts who have had the same issue because of HIPAA and everything. But I would say just keep at it. Also, that's when I lean heavily onto your Chamber of Commerce or your workforce board member, because they can have connections with those in the healthcare field that you may not have thought of. And then I also challenge you to sit down and write, because sometimes we're connected with people and we don't even know it. I was doing a training not too long ago, and a new activity that I've been doing is how do we start looking at that partnership team. And so someone was talking about the health field, and then they didn't realize that their own husband was one of the higher ups in the health field, and they're like, oh, I'll just do that. So sometimes it's who we know as well. But one thing is, too, the reason why I said get connected with your chambers and your workforce, I know for a fact that Pryor was having a hard time with getting students into the healthcare arena. And so one thing that I was able to do was to get that college and career readiness person connected with a health alliance in their specific region. So now they have a face at the table and a voice at the table, and they're moving in the right direction. We're not there all the way yet, but we are. I know for a fact when Dr. Cootie said it, even on some of hers, there was a struggle. My goal is just to say, don't give up. Be very persistent. Don't get weary in doing good work. It's going to be hard. Sometimes it's not always going to be a yes, but keep getting visible, keep showcasing, and even sometimes I recommend have your student write letters of why they're passionate about this particular field in the healthcare arena and why they want to go there, and share that with the business leader and say, we have all these interests. Then talk base about how there's a workforce skills gap in Oklahoma. And anytime, for example, Shawnee Public Schools did this, they had a business lunch and learn, and they really, to start implementing their internship program, And so they asked me to come out from the State Department to give that overview level, what does internships look like? And then they spoke from their district level. So if you do a business lunch and learn, that's something that I will come out to and help you with as well. And what was good about that, they connected with Pioneer Library System and they held it at that library. And then the library system paid for all of the lunch. So it's, again, using those connections that you have. I hope that gave you some thoughtful ideas. If not, you can always reach out to me and we can have more of a one-on-one. Oh, thank you, Michelle, for telling me October 17th is fall break. Well, then y'all know that means we probably will not have this webinar. There's no probably, more than likely that will happen. So thank you so much for letting me know. I did not know that. Okay, let me go back to that slide real fast about internship credit so that you can see it specifically. And before I do that real fast, I mean, one credit for the same you choose the service learning. Okay, so I'm gonna go back to that slide because we have some questions about the credit. So let me get there for you. Okay, so this slide right here, so I'll read it this time. A maximum of 2 high school elective hours of the 6 course hours required per school day can be used for such programs. So that 2 hours, it can include the internship sites. And then of course, if they want to petition for a 3rd hour, then that's when they have to go to the local board and the board has to approve it. So then this last bullet point is very important. The semester course, it may be repeated for elective credit, up to 1 credit per semester and per class is consistent with concurrent enrollment. So you can have up to 2 credits per year for an internship. And so then the next slide right here, these are the internship course codes. 2790 internship 1, 2791 internship 2. I'm gonna go back one more time because there was a question about service learning. Great question. Is the same if you choose to use the service learning. So for service learning, that's a different code altogether. That's code 2775. That's not even an internship code. And just a reminder, a friendly reminder, that course code does not count towards post-secondary opportunities, the indicator. Only the internship course codes 2790 and 2791 will count. Let's see, show 1 4. Earlier mentioned even 1 credit. Sorry, I'm pausing to read a question. So the credit typically, but service learning is a little tricky because you're not going to get that point, but you're going to get that experience per se in meeting the ICAP requirement. As far as what this looks like on the transcript for 2023 or what's kind of the graduation requirements, I'm glad you brought that up, Carrie. Currently, we right now have been working on the 2023 graduation requirements. They're just in the last review process, but they will, once they get live, they will be on the counseling website, and then we will also link them on OK Edge, and I believe it'll be linked close to the ICAP FAQs, but it might be linked a little differently, but look on that implementing ICAP and that'll be there. So that'll break it down a little bit nicely for you as well. And it will have the verbiage about what is service learning and our work-based learning. And so everything I'm saying, it'll be broken down a little bit more specifically also. And yes, Michelle, you are saying that correctly. You understood that correctly. You'll need the 2 credits, which is over a year, 1 per semester. And that will meet the ICAP internship requirement. But let me clarify that. I'm glad you mentioned that, Michelle, because that has been a question. It is not required to have an internship to graduate from high school. So I wanna make sure that's very clear. An internship, it is a type of the work-based learning, so it's a type of that requirement, or excuse me, it's a type of that experience, but you don't have to have an internship to graduate from high school. So hopefully that just cleared it up for you. We just have provided these codes that way if school districts needed to want, because within the first year of the pilot, we had many school districts who said it would be nice to have a course code for internships so that our students are getting credit. And so then we created these codes, and it does align to a law that was out as well, which is on the site. I'm sorry, the House bill evades me right now. However, we created those course codes, and then that was able to get, we put it into our new accountability system for you to be able to get those post-secondary opportunities indicator. So hopefully that cleared up the questions. If there are there any more questions from what I just said? Okay. Okay, I will proceed us along. And if there are more questions that come along, feel free to always put them in the chat or let me know. And again, thank you. I believe it was Michelle who told me about fall break. Thank you so much on that. I wanted to share this with you. This is OK Edge. If you haven't seen it before, I at least wanted you to see what it has to offer. How we've broken it up is under the About section. That is where you're going to find the legislation. So any legislation that is applicable to individual career academic planning, ICAP, will be right there. So you'll have that work-based learning piece of the law. You'll have the law that is focused on the internship course codes. Then you'll have the ICAP law itself, House Bill 2155. I do have that one memorized. And then how we break it down is we go students and families. And under students and families, this is really where elementary, middle school, and high school, we've broken it up these three ways and have provided the resources for them. So if you're in the high school, that's where you can have a campus visit, and we have a checklist that's there. In middle school, what does curriculum look like right there? And then in elementary, we provided resources as well. How does it connect to purposeful play, et cetera? So that's a great one for your parents to come and look on this website, because this, we want this to be the one-stop shop for any information that you need applicable to ICAP, work-based, and work-based learning, and engaging those business and community. Under educators, this is your hub right here, my educators. Supporting your students, implementing the ICAP, that's where you're gonna find the ICAP toolkit. If you haven't looked at that, please look at that. That's a good resource for you. It was actually created by a cadre of counselors who took the time and had you in mind. So look through that. That's very helpful if you are just now getting started with ICAP altogether. Financial aid and scholarships. What does the workforce look like? What are those workforce regions and some information there? Career literacy, how do you get involved? That's the piece that connects you to our, we call it OSDE Connect, which is our online learning community. And then professional development, we just created that, that sector. That's not the right word. We just created that piece for you so that you can actually see any professional development that we do. So if you're thinking about the upcoming Student Success Summit, which I'll mention in a few moments, or the ICAP meeting, so you won't have one on the 17th, the webinar. However, there will be a meeting on October 22nd, and I'll show you that, but that's where you can find all that good information. If you're a business and community and you're wondering, how do I even get this process started pertaining to internships, Chelsea? That's where you go in to find and click on that internship at externships, and you'll find the internship FAQ. And I will show you some of this stuff as well as we continue to proceed. Under business and education partnership guides, that's gonna be a great hub for you. That's where you're gonna find that business and education partnership toolkit. Again, it hasn't been released, but that's where it'll be housed. However, all the one pagers that we created within that toolkit, because we wanted to get information to your into your hands, especially during the time of Engage, are already there for you. So that's where you're gonna find that sample partnership letter and an agreement. You'll find things like an employability skills rubric and assessment. You'll find things like a work reflection template that you can put within your student's portfolio. So if you're using OK College Start or OK Career Guide, you can upload that document after a student completes it and put it there. You'll also find that school calendar, and I was very intentional about making it from January all the way to December, and how you could start intertwining your work-based learning opportunities and experiences, and how businesses can connect with you. And then there's also what I love about this toolkit. It'll be a suggested process to really walk you through a, how does that look like getting started with businesses and what are the suggestions there for you. And then what's great about the toolkit is there's a section I mentioned earlier about the 7 workforce development regions. So what I was purposeful about doing was I went into each region and created core teams. And so various partners from business, from career tech, from higher ed, from school districts, from tribal nations, et cetera, came together and gave you lens on how you can connect with their organization, what their organization can do for you, and what they've already been doing in the capacity of ICAP, and then how do you connect with them? So what's their email, what's their phone? So that all that good information will be there as well. And then how do you connect with local educators? So this site, if you haven't seen it yet or been on it, it's okedge.com. I recommend you go because that's where you're going to find all your resources, again, for individual career academic planning, work-based learning, and industry engagement, and parent and family engagement as well. So some ICAP resources. Again, I wanted you to see it. So now here's the direct link to OKEdge, the direct link to the ICAP toolkit, and then, as I mentioned, our online learning community, a direct link for you there as well. And what's good about this OSDE Connect is that, and I'll mention this a few slides from now, but we use this as a virtual careers in the classroom. So you're now able to connect with various business leaders virtually, so you don't have to leave your classroom or they don't have to leave their office. And it's been very interesting to see, especially we utilized this in our ICAP pilot district when it came to Oklahoma Career Exposure Week. And so we learned a lot from that, and now we are going to be opening that up statewide. But I will show a slide in the coming slides for you. Another resources to make sure you have these. If you haven't chosen your tool yet, you have OK College Start or OK Career Guide. And after I said that, if there's a question about have we as the State Department said you have to have this tool or this tool, no. We want that, again, that's your local decision. We want you know your students best, you know your school site best, and we want you to have the free will to be able to choose which tool is going to be the most feasible for you. But I wanted you to have links to OK College Start and OK Career Guide training so you can see if you haven't scheduled a training with your person. So if it's OK College Start, that is going to be Teresa Shackley. And if it's OK Career Guide, that's going to be AJ Crowell. And both of their information and all of this is also linked on OK Edge. And I'm about to share about an upcoming conference that they will be at, and so I'm inviting you to that as well. And then they both, as I mentioned, they did a webinar, a part of this series as well. So that's the most recent information on OK College Start and how to implement it with ICAP. And the same is true with OK Career Guide, how does that relate to ICAP career development for students pre-K through 12, because they have a new product, which is known as Galaxy, and that is more for elementary age. Now online for you, if you did go to Engage OK or you didn't get a chance to, we now have the 2019 Engage OK presentations. We had a total of 6 college and career readiness presentations for you. So many were focused on ICAP, and then you had some focused on work-based learning, how do you engage community partners, and then guidance on post-secondary opportunities. So check those out. What's good about the work-based learning and engaging and even the guidance, I brought in outside presenters with me who spoke those lenses, so you can hear it specifically from them. And some of them were the workforce executive direct, so you can see what they look like as well. Well, you won't see that, but you'll at least see the slide information. Some internship resources that are now available for you on OK Edge is that internship FAQs. Just to be honest with you, I'm about to revise that just a little bit, but the content will most likely stay the same. The only content you wouldn't have seen is the question about can internships be paid or unpaid. I finally got clarity on that not last week, and so you'll see that information denoted, but I had it in the slide for you. And then, of course, the direct link to the business and community partnership guides. coming soon. We have a lot of good information that's about to be out for you. Pausing real fast for a question. Okay, good question. If an internship is not required for graduation, is it not required for a student to complete their ICAP? So to that question, and I'm going back to the law. So House Bill 2155 says that a student has to have experience in service learning and or it says work environment activities, but I'm calling it work-based learning. And what that means, internship is a component. It's a piece of work-based learning, but it's there's a scale. So you can start with job shadowing, a mixture of mentorship, and then proceeding to career fairs and virtual career fairs and project-based learning and the service learning. An internship is kind of like at the top level. Not everyone does an internship or has it, but if you do an internship, we've got the course credit for you. So it's not, again, it's not a requirement for graduation, but it's still a piece of the ICAP requirement because of that last bullet point that says experience in service learning and our work, work-based learning. Did that provide clarity for you? Okay, I'll wait until the response. Back to the slideshow. So coming soon, some things that we're trying to get into your hands, that business and education partnership toolkit, the individual career academic planning, the ICAP, the tiny toolkit, and pause. Michelle, send me an email off base and I'd love to talk to you more one-on-one with that. And then of course, I mentioned earlier the 2023 graduation requirements. So those are the things to start looking for. They're not there yet, but they are in the works to get to you, in the coming weeks. That's our goal. Another thing, if you're not familiar with this, Oklahoma College App Week of 2019, mark your calendars. That's going to be September 23rd through the 27th. Oklahoma College App Week, it's really that opportunity for those high school seniors, especially those who never even thought about going to college or will be the first generation in their family to go to college, to get that hands-on experience or just getting knowledge about what is college even look like. So to register, you would just click there, and I'll correct that before I send you guys the slide, but that's the direct link for that. Okay, Wendy, good question. So Wendy's question was, and statement as well, not all students can fit an internship into their schedules. That's correct. What are the other areas to meet their ICAP requirement? So other areas that will meet the ICAP requirement is you can host a career fair, and if you do, I'm a person, you got to provide me with so much documentation because you want that to show that your student went to a career fair and then they reflected upon that piece and what does that look like. A student watched or participated in a virtual careers in the classroom. They heard from this speaker. This connects to their career path by this. They were interested in this. They gleaned this or they didn't glean this. So reflection pieces are what's going to be the best thing for you in any of these activities. Job shadowing. So my student wants to go and they want to be, maybe they want to be a veterinarian one day. And so they want to go job shadow their local kennel. And so they go and they shadow that kennel person for a whole day and see what it's like to do a business plan, see what it's like to take the dogs and cats out and in and whatever is involved in a kennel. And then they come back and they have them write a paper on it, have them write a reflection time on that. So then they can upload those documents within their portfolio. Another thing would be a mentorship. So maybe they're participating, your school is doing a mentorship program. So maybe you're connecting with maybe, for instance, the Boys and Girls Club of Oklahoma County. And so you send some of your students there and you want mentors or however you set up your mentorship program. That's a piece of it. Another piece would be an apprenticeship. So if your student goes and they're doing a paid apprenticeship or unpaid apprenticeship, but they're still gleaning from that person or that individual who they're, you know, assisting, then that's a part of it. Of course, internships is one piece of work-based learning. Did that help give you some ideas? Okay, great. Next question, can students do internships over the summer? That's actually a very good question, Alicia. And I don't believe you're the first who's asked me this question. How we have it is, and I will get back with you on this one, Alicia, because I don't think I've gotten clarification yet. But right now, it's how you write it in your district policy on how these internships are going to happen. So we're providing you the guidance, but you it's how your district policy is written. So, I mean, it really is that local control. So if your district policy has that, but right now what I've been informed is, or what my knowledge has been, is that these course codes only are applicable to in the semester time. So that's a good question on the summer, Alicia. Long story short, let me get back with you. It's a question I have asked. We have had conversations between myself, my Office of Accountability and Accreditation. So these are, I promise you, your questions that you're coming my way. Thank you for asking. Keep them coming. So I will need a little bit more guidance on that one just to clarify. But Alicia, if you will, in this chat box, because I'll get this information, provide me with your, and you can do it privately as well if you'd like, provide me with your email and your contact information so I can touch base with you one-on-one. And then, of course, for the whole group, because I'm sure this is applicable for everyone, I will send out, once I have that in writing on my clarification, I will send it out to the whole group. So thank you for bringing that to my attention. Okay, going back to the slide, and I'll keep going back and forth because I want to make sure I get your questions answered. So again, College App Week is September 23rd through the 27th. Professional development, I mentioned earlier about monthly ICAP meetings. Marissa Lightsey will host these meetings and answer any of your questions as it pertains to ICAP. What does that look like from career development stance? And all of that information. So the next one is going to be September 24th. Then the following one is October 22nd. And then the next one, November 19th. And all those links, you're able to register for those events. Really want you to get this on your calendar, thank you, Alicia, is to let you know about the Student Success Summit. And this is upcoming on October 7th of 2019. This is really an exciting summit because not only are we talking about ICAP, but we're talking about how does ICAP connect to hope and resiliency. So we will have in the morning session, Dr. Chan Hellman, who's going to talk about trauma and how that relates to hope and resiliency, and then also talk about how it all ties into ICAP. And then in our afternoon sessions, we will have a plethora of different sessions ranging from, we will have a panel of different districts who participated in ICAP to give that perspective. We will have those from Career Tech and Higher Ed to give perspective on how does that relate to foster care? How does ICAP relate to athletics? How does it relate to business and community engagement? How does it relate to family engagement? We will have that. We will also have some specific ICAP sessions in relation to elementary and in relation to middle school, because I know sometimes we have focused a lot of PD on high school, but we want to make sure that the middle school and elementary school educators are well informed on what ICAP is and how you can intertwine activities. So great summit coming up. Registration link is right there, so hope you are able to join us on, again, October 7th from 8 to 3. That's Monday, and it'll be at Embassy Suites Hotel in Norman. Mark your calendars for Guidance Fest 2019. Okay, good question. Is the Student Success Summit the same, similar as those offered this summer? Susan, are you referencing the ICAP trauma sessions that were combined this summer? Are you talking about Engage OK? If you're talking about Engage OK, then no, this is going to be more extensive, and it's going to really be a focus on the trauma aspect, the hope aspect, and the ICAP piece. If you're talking about the ICAP and trauma, a little bit of it, but we're going to have a keynote who he is going to talk that space, and then we'll break it up. And so there will be some sessions that will be focused on trauma-informed practices and strategies in relation to ICAP, but it'll be a mixture of various sessions. So there'll be middle school focus, elementary focus, of course, high school, some what does it look like, CTE. So I think it'll be a little different, not engaged with the trauma. Thank you. Yeah, it'll be, Susan, great question. It's different than the trauma and ICAP. Beth will still be there, and she will do that activity that you guys connected with on the hope and resiliency and kind of piece there, but that'll just be one session. The afternoon sessions are completely different. The morning will maybe a little similar to the trauma and ICAP piece, but that's going to be from an outsider perspective and who's had the work in founding the Hope Foundation Center, I believe in Norman. So yeah, it'll be different. Similar, but not the same. I know that was kind of confusing, but I hope that answered your question. Mark your calendars for Guidance Fest. Guidance Fest begins in October. It goes all throughout October, but this is a link for you. These are held by Oklahoma Career Tech and local career tech centers, and it's really for the partner schools, principals, instructors, a whole range of information, but I just got this into my hands, so I wanted to make sure you got it into your hands. And then the next thing, it's early, but in 2020, we're going to do the Oklahoma Career Exposure Week. And again, I mentioned we will be using our online learning community. We are currently working on a schedule to get into your hands so that you can sign up as a school district. And right now I'm working on the businesses as well. So as soon as we get that formalized, we will get it into your hands so that you can see it. But we're just trying to promote it earlier this year to get better engagement. But any information you need is right there for you. Of course, stay connected with our College and Career Readiness. Some of this information you will see. I'm finalizing the newsletter, so my hope is to get it out really before in the coming weeks. I'll say it like that. And then connect with us. We have a new way for you to connect with us, kind of to streamline our process. So this link gets you to a smart sheet in a sense, and so then it's disseminated to the appropriate party that you need. So we're happy and here to help you, and we want to make sure that our time and our response to you is quick. Rather than a whole week to get back with you. I want to thank you for your time, answer any last minute questions. I know we went a little over, so I do appreciate you all staying with me onto the session. Again, the session is being recorded and we will get it to you, but are there any last minute questions for me? Oh, great question, Alicia. Does the Student Success Summit provide professional development points? Yes, we will have professional development points, and we also will have CEUs as well. So if you're an LPC, you'll get that also. Thank you for asking that question. Any other questions? Okay, if there are no other questions, again, thank you so much for joining this webinar. I will touch base with you if you sent me your contact information, and I will get that disseminated to the group. And again, you should receive this by tomorrow, this recorded webinar and the PowerPoint. Thank you all again. Have a great rest of your day.